are quite multidisciplinary. We've got people as well as ecology. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about some of the policy work we've done in Australia. So the short story is this. I started off my life as a biochemist and a mathematician who liked bird watching. And as I left Australia to go to England for a Rhodes Scholarship, I said to the newspaper, I will come back to Australia and I will help save its biodiversity. And it's strangely enough, that's what I've been doing for the last 30 years. And I said I will use my interests in mathematics to do that. And that's what I've been doing for the last 30 years. But what happened 20 years ago when I was on a study leave at Imperial College is I sort of realised that most of ecology was not being used in decision making, and actually arguably hardly ever any of it still is used in decision making. And the reason is everybody else who uses science to help to make decisions uses some form of decision theory to do that. Engineers would never go and build a bridge without thinking about money, safety, economics, people's values. But also they're using a whole heap of physics. I mean, an engineer that has no physics will build a bridge that will fall down. So the trouble is we have physicists and then we have engineers, and you would never get a physicist to build a bridge, would you? You don't go to the physics department and say, could you please build us a bridge? We would not walk on that bridge. The physics people I know are brilliant, but they don't build bridges. But what have we got in ecology? We're building national park systems and marine park systems that are changing the face of, what, 10, 20% of the entire surface area of the planet? We don't have a discipline of ecological engineering, really. We don't have a whole heap of people, a profession like engineering, which has been around for a long, long time, that turns the basic science of ecology, like engineers turn the basic science of physics, into something that makes a bridge. We have not had that, and we're only just struggling to get it. And it's meant to be called this thing called conservation biology, but even that's a really stupid name, isn't it? I mean, the Journal of Conservation Biology, I love it to death, but why did we call it the Journal of Conservation Biology? Ecological applications. I mean, these are still people who are largely publishing papers that are about ecology and conservation of rare and threatened ecosystems, so it's all very useful. But they are informing people about making decisions that include people's values, social science issues and economics issues, and they never talk about it other than the fact that right at the end of the paper they've just put 17,000 radio trackers on some sad, lonely albatrosses and followed them around the sea, and they say this is where they go and this is where they feed and this should inform marine protected areas. That's the last paragraph of their paper in the Journal of Conservation Biology or Biological Conservation. Well, that's not right. So we are missing an entire discipline. And so I've spent 20 years trying to convince people we're missing a discipline, and that is the people who use decision science and the science of applied mathematics, economics and engineering. They're all decision scientists. They're all operations research people taking all that stuff and taking that to people who actually do make decisions, which are managers and policymakers, and hoping they'll use it. And I can tell you it's not that easy, and I will try and talk about some success, but for everything I say is successful, I can tell you there is 1,000 failures, so it's slow and painful. So that's basically what the talk is about. I also might add, although I've been trying to do this for 20 years, I haven't been doing it alone. In fact, arguably, I don't do much more now than just swan around the planet giving silly talks. And they're all the people, they're old pictures. I have currently 30 PhD students, 16 of whom I'm the primary advisor. I have 15 postdocs. I direct two centres which have over 600 researchers in 12 universities, and we have collaborating organisations across the entire country and internationally, and they do all the stuff, and I just take all the credit, really. It's good. It's a good system if you can work it out. And if nobody else realises that's what you're doing, don't tell anybody. Okay, so this is the general outline of the talk. And I suppose if you wanted a take-home message from the perspective of actually getting things done, I would have to say somehow you need to find somebody in the management agency, in the policy area, could be a politician, It's usually a senior public servant who actually cares and believes in what you're doing. Otherwise, it's definitely impossible, and that will be obvious. What I'm going to do is start incredibly simply. I'm assuming that you have never heard one of my boring talks before, but that's why you're here. And so this start example is a toy example, but it's really indicative of a large body of many pieces of work. It's about threatened species prioritisation. Then I'm going to talk about spatial planning. Then I'm going to just end a little bit and ask you to reflect on those of you who care about science and want to do science that makes a difference. What is the value of information? The one-line sentence there is, if that scientific data does not potentially change a decision, I don't care. Okay. So lots of scientific data improves knowledge. Vast amount of it actually doesn't change any decisions. Therefore, it's not applied science, which may seem a bit harsh. Okay. I don't want to patronise you. This is a ridiculously simple example. But this example is the simplest way I can point out how abysmal decision-making in governments and NGOs and provinces and organisations around the world. This is a global problem, so nobody does it very well. And this is the simplest way I can explain it. So I'm now, you're in charge of a mythical country. And that mythical country has four species in it, and they're all threatened. And the IUCN, bless their cotton socks, have classified everything in the world as to whether it's critically endangered or vulnerable, and we can roughly assign an extinction probability to those things. And people have been talking about this triage issue for a long time. What do most governments, provinces, regions in the planet do when they're looking at all the money they've got to allocate to threatened species? They go to the species that's most endangered, and they start spending money on that. So we'll spend money on Sumatran tigers, and then if we've got some left over, we might spend it on this orchid. Does anybody here like plants? Oh, good, Steve, there you go. Does anybody like insects? Sorry. They're not in there. So that's what we do. And Australia has 1,760 federally listed species. I have to know that because I'm in directing a centre that's meant to save them all. What's the chance Australia can save 1,760 endemic listed species? And that's only the ones we know about it, and has hardly any invertebrates on that list at all. That's all largely vascular plants and invertebrates. No chance at all. Three quarters of those species we do virtually nothing about. And the case study I'm going to show you in a minute, New Zealand, is even a worse situation. Almost everything they have is endemic. They have long, long lists of threatened species, and their economy is even smaller than ours. So people sort of realised that, and they sort of thought, oh, we haven't got much money. All we're doing is working on critically endangered species, and we're often spending a lot of money on them. There are other things we need to think about. So some people have started thinking, well, it's not just about spending the money on the things that are going to go extinct. Some species might cost more. These are completely fabricated numbers, quite obviously, more expensive than others. And also some things, let's say the polar bear, well, maybe the Arctic ice sheet just disappears anyway, and we can do nothing about it. So even if we have a wonderful project action program, recovery plan for polar bears that costs $5 million over the next 20 years, it goes extinct anyway. So the probability of success is low. So I've got three numbers there, and we now know we need to combine them, and people have sort of been struggling with that for a while. So a few places try and deal with that. They may even have a few other factors in there. And what do they typically do? Well, they know they need to be quantitative. They know that cost does matter. I mean, look at it. We could save the other three species just for the cost of the Sumatran tiger, so it must matter. But how are we going to combine those three numbers in a logical fashion that gives us a prioritisation? Now imagining we've got 1,000 species on this list. So what do they typically do? This is what everybody does. This is how most of the spatial planning in the world happens. We just turn these numbers into scores out of 5 or 10, and we add them up. So we're going to give high scores for more threatened species. I mean, if we save the koala, what did we save? Well, it probably wasn't going to go extinct anywhere, so we didn't save much. So we should give a low score here and a high score there. So we'll do that, low score, high score. High probabilities of success, well, they're good projects, aren't they? So we'll give them high scores. Cheap projects should get high scores. Expensive projects should get low scores, so we'll put scores in there. And then we're going to add them up because we've got some numbers. What do you do with numbers? You add them. That's easy to do. We can do it on a spreadsheet, and you should send all your money to Australia. because koalas, which aren't bears, are the things that we need to save. Okay, that's great. So so 90% of places in the world just spend their money on the most endangered species. A few places have realised there's other factors and they do things like this. And there's only two places in the world that do it right. There is only one logical way of combining those numbers. And what is that logical way of combining those numbers? Does anybody know? Nobody came here having read all my papers, this background reading and thinking. And the logical way of combining those three numbers, believe it or not, is something that you all do every day. It's called shopping. Well, actually, some of you probably don't do it every day. I don't do it. But all you have to do is know how to shop. All you have to do is know cost effectiveness. And the trouble is, we have a whole group of people around the world in charge of spending money with fixed budgets to achieve biodiversity outcomes. It might not be threatened species. It might be, I've got a park. I've got a budget of $500,000 a year. I'm not going to save the biodiversity of the park. It might be building a marine protected area system. Every single one of these natural resource managers we have around the country who care about biodiversity at all spatial scales, from the little county park level to the entire nation, have the same resource allocation problem, and virtually none of them, one in a million of them, use a rational approach to allocating their funds. The rational approach, and the very, very simple approach, it's not perfect, is cost effectiveness. They didn't pose a problem. What is cost effectiveness? It's benefit divided by cost. You buy the project that gives you the greatest expected benefit divided by the cost of the project. What is that? The expected benefit is B, that is, if I save this tiger, I'm getting 0.9 of a species because there was a 0.9% chance, 90% chance it was going to go. If I save this, I don't get a lot of benefit because it probably was going to save itself. That's the benefit of the project. This is the probability of success. That's the cost, B times P over C. And remarkably, even though the other approach was completely rational and logical, we now get exactly the reverse answer. The koala's on the bottom. You don't have to spend your money in Australia anymore. We should spend our money on the orchid. Okay, that is the right answer. There's a mathematical proof the problem from a... Who here is an expert on integer linear programming? Thank God. That's wonderful, because now I can say whatever I like. Integer linear programming delivers you the knapsack problem. The knapsack problem is this project problem. The knapsack problem is I'm going hiking. I've got a 20-litre backpack. I can carry 20 kilograms. I can only fit so much in. What shall I take? Yes, I might like to take a sleeping bag. Otherwise, I will die. Oh, it would be good to have some food, wouldn't it? Do I need 7 bars of chocolate? Maybe not. Okay. So that's the knapsack problem. How do I stuff as much in my pack to make me as happy as possible? The benefit is happiness. P is the probability it works. So if you pack eggs, half of them might break. The cost is the amount or weight or volume that it consumes in your backpack. That's all we're doing. We've got a fixed budget. We're stuffing our backpack full of items. This is the problem you solve when you go shopping. If you go to supermarket A and they sell you 20 kilograms of bananas for $10, because you've got a hungry orangutan at home, and another place sells you 30 kilograms for $12, you're going to buy 20 kilograms for $10 or 30 kilograms for $12, you work out maximising bananas per dollar or minimising dollars per banana. You do that every day. In fact, there's people somewhere in the highlands of New Guinea or the forests of Peru who do this without even thinking. If you can't do cost effectiveness, there's about, 20,000 years of human evolution where we have traded, if not 100,000 years of human evolution, you would have died because somebody would have ripped you off. So isn't it odd? This is the incredible thing is, here is the only logical, transparent and actually intuitively reasonable way of allocating funds to these species. Assuming all species are equal, okay, we can add in, if you're thinking, I think koalas are much more important than orchids, we can add that in. But assuming all species are equal, this is the only way to do it. How can it be that we have so many organisations and agencies not doing this? And you might think, well, that's lovely to write papers about that. In fact, I wasn't the first person to write a paper about this. There was an economist called Weitzman who did it, and we did work on it. We wrote papers. We wrote more complicated papers, more complicated algorithms. And you might say, well, that's lovely, that's all theoretical, but does it really work? Well, when I mentioned it to the Australian government in 1998, and I sit on a lot of government committees, both at the federal and state levels, I spend 30 or 40 days a year, every year, working for the government for free, they laughed at me and said, you can't do that, you're triaging things. And I said, I'm prioritising things. And they said, no, you're triaging things. And I said, I'm prioritising things. And then we ran around that debate for a few days or years. New Zealand read some of our stuff, and this one person called Richard Maloney said, we have a problem. New Zealand has a lot of threatened species. And they had at least 700 where they had some sort of recovery plan for them, and they were working on about 100 or 120 of those species, and they were spending a lot of money on some highly endangered species. They said, we're going to do it. So they did it. And they did it in 2 years. They went through over 700 species, they came up with a plan, they costed the plan, they worked out whether it was going to work, they worked out what was enough to secure each of those 700 species, that is 32 of those species. And they actually had a lot of invertebrates on their list. They don't have mammals other than some marine mammals and some bats. And in the end, they ranked them by cost effectiveness. And then you might say, well, what this, sorry, you've got C and B and S. What's this W thing here? That weighting. So they actually weighted all the species based on their taxonomic uniqueness or phylogenetic distinctiveness. So that was their choice. It was a rigorous, repeatable, transparent way. Basically, if you're a Kiwi and there's only five Kiwi species in the world, and then they're certainly in their own genus, and I think they're in their own family, then you get a really high score. But if you happen to be another grasshopper, you get a really, really low score because there are lots of species in your genus and lots of genera in your family. But Kiwi's up there. I think if you look at number five, there's the Kiwi. It's expensive, but it has a high uniqueness. So I don't mind how you weight your species, as long as it's quantitative. What's a good way of, if you don't want to weight them by how taxonomically distinctive they are, you could weight them by ecosystem function. Can anybody put a number on the ecosystem function of every species in the world? No, not yet. What else could we do? There's a prize for this, if you can tell me another good way of putting a quantitative value on a species from a social perspective, and you get an issue of our monthly magazine, worth thousands to many people, really about $1.50. Yep. Like the umbrella keystone species effect. Keystone species effect. Yeah. Do you reckon we can get that number for everything in the world? Some. You might. Yep. That's another good one. But it probably most species we still won't know. I know, for example, cassowaries in Australia, if we take them out, we're probably going to lose 1,000 species because they disperse 50 species of rainforest tree that's not dispersed by anything else. Multiply that by 20 for invertebrates, you get 1,000 species. Flying foxes, things like that. What's a really simple... Willingness to pay. You could ask lots of people how much they'd pay. I don't like willingness to pay studies, but they're good. What's a good way of doing a willingness to pay study on 700 species without actually talking to people? Because we're scientists and we don't want to talk to people. And using your computer, and you could do it now. You could. Yeah, that's close enough. Google it. See how many hits you get. Flickr it. Whatever. Enter herring-nosed wombat. And you'll see that there's whatever it is, 2 million hits. Enter robust grasshopper and there's 2,300 hits. So I don't know. That's a number. At least it's a number. And you could argue about it, and then you could enter rhinoceros and say, was it a black rhinoceros or white rhinoceros? And we could argue about that for a while. But in the end, yeah, as long as you've got a quantifiable value. So that's one way of doing it. Nobody's done it like that. New South Wales have adopted this same method. They're spending $100 million on threatened species. The reason why they actually got $100 million is because they have a right-wing government in New South Wales. The conservation organisation went to them and said, we have a method that is cost-effective that will deliver a much bigger bang for the buck. We need more money. And a right-wing government gave them $100 million. So if you speak economics to right-wing governments, they sort of like it. New Zealand can save 2.5 times as many species as they used to by using this approach. That's what they're doing. The US Fish and Wildlife Service has started looking at now, and they've asked us to do some work on it and see how it would work for them. Although they spend most of their time being sued, so it's quite hard for them to do anything at all. And there's various discussions about this. I think me arguing with Stuart Pym, and other people about this is triage and that's terrible and we shouldn't do it. I struggle to see how you can logically defend anything that doesn't use this approach. And there's various wrinkles you can put onto it. There is a whole heap of maths that support it. So what do I do? What do I do? I really do very little because my PhD students and postdocs do everything, but I come up with this little bit, which is basically says allocate a whole heap of money. That says allocate a whole heap of money to projects that cost a certain amount within a budget and maximise the number of species I saved above and beyond what I would have otherwise got. So that's the only talent I have. I used to be a clever recorder, but that's it. And this sort of concept can apply to lots of other problems. So we looked at the Kimberley. The Kimberley is this huge piece of Australia in the northwest of the country. It's virtually empty. I don't know how big it is. It's about 500 kilometres by 500 kilometres. It's Australia's, the only part of Australia that actually has an intact mammal fauna, which is quite depressing, given how much our mammal fauna has been massacred. And we don't have projects for all these species. In fact, not many species are listed. It's largely untouched. But we have major issues to do with feral cats, cattle, donkeys, introduced herbivores and weeds. And what we did is we used the same concept, but instead of prioritising species, in fact, that first example doesn't prioritise species. It prioritises actions, and the actions deliver benefit to a single species. But when you think about it, a lot of the actions you're taking or people are taking in management agencies, those actions help lots of species. And in New Zealand, that's not always the case, because so many of their threatened species are on one side of a hill, in one little spot, in one little river system. So most of their actions are only helping one species, so the overlap's low. But in this sort of extensive landscape, and I assume a lot of the extensive landscapes in Canada, many of the broad-scale actions and policies you want to roll out have multiple species. So we actually calculate that. What is the benefit? This is the number of different species that we would hope to secure by this investment in this activity, and this is the chance it would work. And all we do is, again, divide benefit divided by cost, and we weight the benefit by the feasibility. So that's where it's published in Conservation Letters. And so we've done that. We can apply this at multiple scales. All you have to do is think of some actions, work out how much they cost over a period of time, work out what they deliver. And of course, there's an enormous amount of expert opinion. A lot of judgment makes a lot of people very anxious. Your experts initially will back away from it and say this is too vague, but ultimately you end up with a rational allocation towards broad scale projects. And this one also helped deliver another $10 million a year to conservation. So maybe the talk can end now. I've told you that all you have to do to know anything about management and the thing that most organisations are not doing is all you have to know is to know how to shop. All of that assumed there is very little dependency between all the actions. The benefits are independent and the costs are independent and the probabilities of success are independent. And that independence between the actions will generally, often, occasionally be roughly right. And it's good and it's simple and it's very easy to follow and you can do it on a spreadsheet. But in a lot of complicated spatial planning processes, what I do here affects what happens somewhere else. And so we actually go backwards in time to the world of spatial planning and the development of spatial planning tools. And I'm not going to berate you about spatial planning tools and marine reserve design and terrestrial reserve design for too long. I really want to use this as an example more to tell you, again, a successful case of how we've used quantitative tools in conservation decision-making that's now global, that also can completely stuff up. Okay, so this is going to be a good, happy story, and it's going to be a sad story at the same time. The happy story is this. And the happy story is around the rezoning of the Great Barrier Reef. As you would all know, every country in the world has signed an agreement where every country is meant to conserve 10% of its EEZ, and I think Canada may well have the biggest marine EEZ in the planet. Is that true? I think it might be close. Australia's is about 9 million square kilometres. Australia's exclusive economic zone is as big as Australia. Generally, we haven't done a very good job of marine protected areas. Actually, I keep forgetting to fix this slide. That's now supposedly 3%, but just in the last 5 years, the marine protected area system in the planet has gone from about 1% to 3%, which is amazing. However, Some of the processes about where they're put are fairly erratic. In the past, in fact, marine protected areas were generally put right next to a marine station where somebody put on scuba and suddenly got into the water and said, gee, there's lots of ascidians down here. I didn't know there were 200 species of brown algae. This is amazing. Let's make it a marine reserve. That was it. That was the thinking. And that's not bad because we've got a few little marine reserves. And now, why are we getting marine reserves? Because presidents and prime ministers who are about to lose office decide they're going to make huge marine reserves because they want to make the biggest marine reserve in the world. And so that's the competition on at the moment. I'm not sure Canada's joined the competition, but maybe you can convince them to. And they just take big whacks of sea in the middle of nowhere, usually where they've never been, and they call it a marine park. Fortuitously, we've been working on spatial planning and reserve system design for a long time, and this is work that was started by many people in this continent, in Canada and the United States, but also in Australia. It's certainly not started by me. It's just that we happen to have produced the software that does most of that spatial planning. So what is spatial planning? And this is another tiny toy example. If you get this, then you know everything you need to know. I have some places, and there's 8 places, and I want to buy them, and I want to make them parks. And if I make them a park, the population of these birds, because birds is the only important biodiversity in the world, the population of those birds that are in those places will be saved. And if I don't buy them, they'll be turned into cotton fields, and those birds will disappear. I want to save all the birds. So if I just said that, save all the birds, you could say buy every place, and I'll charge you $1 million per property. So buy every place. $8 million would cost me. But then I said, well, I only want each of these as a viable breeding population. I just want one viable breeding population of each of them. I could have said 3, but I'll just say 1 for the time being. I'll assume that's fine. What site shall I buy? To be cheapest, to save as much money as possible. I don't want to spend lots of money on national parks. I want to grow some cotton as well. So what shall I buy? And if nobody answers the question, the lecture never ends. Yeah. CD, well done. Congratulations. Now, you meant to say A, B, and C, so you've just ruined my example, because you meant to say A, B, and C, because look at A. Isn't it wonderful? It's got 8 species in it. You're too smart. And once I've got A, I need B and C. But if you're very quick and you can look at these boards and assimilate information really quickly, you'll see I can get everything with those 2. So what have I just shown you? I've just shown you that cost effectiveness, I just spent you 30 minutes telling you how wonderful cost effectiveness is. I've just now shown you how cost effectiveness doesn't work. Because these are all the same costs. The most cost effective sites are A, and then B and C are pretty good. This is rubbish. But it perfectly complements the other site. Now, if you think not just about, this is the concept of complementarity, this is now a much more complicated problem. It's not just ranking every action in the world by cost effectiveness. I could have different costs. I could have different benefits, I could have different areas in there, I could make it much more complicated. That won't work. And so why is this such a hard problem? Well, now imagine we're going to go, then this is the problem. This is the problem. The problem, the reserve design problem is this. Every place in the world is either in or out of the reserve system. I have a matrix that tells me which species are in which sites. I can buy some sites. They cost me money, and I want to minimise the amount of money I spend, and I want to make the reserve system compact, which I didn't tell you about in that last example because you didn't know where the reserves were. So the marine and terrestrial spatial planning problem in its simplest sense is really a process of turning the desire to conserve everything properly as cheaply as possible in a reasonably compact system turned into mathematics. Mathematics is not a science, mathematics is a language. Remember you were in probably year 10 or senior year of high school or year 12 and your maths or science teacher said mathematics is a language and you thought they were crazy? Crazy maths teachers? Well, they were right. That's just saying I can buy every site or not. I want to meet my conservation targets. I want to, in a marine sense, annoy as few people as possible because you don't buy marine reserves, you just displace fishing effort and you make people really angry. And you want to make it a compact system. So what have I done? I've translated humans' hopes, dreams, and fears into equations. I could have translated it into French, but I can't speak French. I should have, because that would have been politically correct in Canada, but I don't know any French. So I turned it into maths. If I turned it into French, well, I can't solve the problem. I turned it into a maths, I can now pull on 70 years of operations research, and they love solving these problems. They think they're great. And in fact, you might think, how complicated is this problem? Why do we need any software to do these problems? Well, the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park problem, which is not that, which was rezoning the entire Great Barrier Reef, had 17,000 sites and had 250 habitats and species and turtle nesting grounds. So now you've got a matrix, and the numbers aren't ones and zeros, they're areas. The number of possible solutions to the problem with 17,000 sites is 2 to the power 17,000. Every site could be in or out. 2 to the power 17,000, which is roughly 10 to the power 5,000. 10 to the power 5,000, that's 1 followed by 5,000 zeros. So why can't we just set our computers and evaluate every option? Think about that. 1 followed by 5,000 zeros. The number of protons in the universe. How many protons are there in the universe? Quickly. You've never looked. Can't be bothered. Not important to you. Apparently, there's only 10 to the 80, which makes me quite anxious, because it just doesn't seem like enough. That's the number of protons in the universe. I thought there'd be 10 to 80 in me, but there's 10 to 80 in the entire universe, and 90% of them are dark matter, and nobody knows where it is and what it is. So the number of solutions to rezoning the entire Great Barrier Reef is like the number of protons in the universe, if every proton had a universe in it, more or less. So you can't set your computer. So we created some software, and that software is called Marksan, and that's used extensively around the world to help people build marine reserve systems that meet their targets, annoy as few people as possible, are reasonably compact and connected, and there's a whole heap of other things we can do with those systems as well. And British Columbia is a big user of our software. They've used it on the land and they've used it in the sea. I gather that it actually hasn't changed anything that really happens in the sea, because there's not much of a marine reserve system in Canada, but I'm sure sometime or other in the next few years, now you have a new government, it will. Does it really get used? Does it happen? Is it only rich countries like Australia that can do it? Australia did a really good job on the Great Barrier Reef. No, this is stuff we did with Conservation International and the Nature Conservancy in Rajarampat. Rajarampat is this part of the world here on the western end of Irian Jaya in Indonesia, arguably the most biodiverse tropical marine ecosystem in the entire planet. People go snorkeling, scuba diving for 2 hours. I think they counted and recorded 328 fish species in 2 hours, one person. You can't write that fast, can you? It just seems impossible. But that's what they did. So this is crazy in terms of diversity, very important. That's why CII and TNC are there. And they use our software. They work with both local community groups and provincial governments, and they scribbled on maps. And not only did they produce a marine reserve system that meets all these conservation targets, they actually produced a zoning system. This is the zoning system which informed, this isn't the actual final set of zones, but not only did they produce these red areas, which are, you can't go there, they're marine parks. Interesting, in that part of the world, they demanded that the marine parks would be coloured red, not green. And actually, I've suddenly realised that's so much more logical, isn't it? You can't go there. You can't fish there. Green is the local community fishing zone, so we actually allow them to set targets for, say, sea cucumber harvest or various forms of artisanal fishing that would meet the needs of all the different villages in this region. And the white stuff is people can do what they like. So the software does that. It meets targets. It minimises impacts. In fact, benefits local communities and gives you reasonably rational arguments that you can take and negotiate with at all sorts of levels, and people who've barely seen a computer before are quite comfortable living with that sort of outcome. Okay, so that sounds like a really, this is fabulous. So isn't this wonderful? I can die happy. So we've got this software, lots of people are using it, we're training people up in it, we've just got to wean people off funny things like species richness maps, all going well. You've just got to wait till the government is ready to do it. So what about that? Australia, where the software comes from, and in fact there's a lot of people in Australia, Bob Pressey, Chris Margules, who've been famous in the world of spatial planning, far more influential than I ever have been, and they've produced also software. So this is Australia's new marine reserve system. So surely this is a wonderful marine reserve system. We've got tons of data, we've got tons of money. Fishing industry is not even that important to us in Australia. It's a tiny bit of our economy compared to your economy, because we have quite impoverished waters. But biodiversity is a big part of our economy. The Great Barrier Reef supposedly makes us $5 billion a year. Fishing in the Great Barrier Reef makes us about $150 million a year. $5 billion, $150 million. So that's why it was an easy win. That's why we got this wonderful solution here. So what about this? This has been sitting on the table. I and several others went to our federal environment minister in 1996 and said, let's do this. By about 2010, we had this sort of map. By 2015, this is still not being implemented. So this is 9 million. This is an area the size of Western Europe of potential marine protected areas. There's a zoning plan that hasn't been implemented. Is it a good zoning plan? Have a quick look at it. The green stuff is the full no-take areas. Let's have a little more detailed look at it. And this is the Kimberley region I was talking about before. Vast wilderness area. We're talking about now, this is 400 kilometres. This is East Timor and Indonesia over here, where we've taken away a lot of their sea because we're bullies. And these are the marine parks we've put in place. The scale here is enormous. Have we built a representative reserve system? Even if we join nothing other than these are different geomorphological features, this is the percentage that's been conserved. So here we have a country with a federal government that's on side, sophisticated data, sophisticated software, and we've built an incredibly good reserve system if you really, really care about the abyssal plain. Okay, what's the abyssal plain? I don't know, I've never been there. It's 3,000 metres deep. I think it could be quite black. But don't worry about the abyssal plain, it's well protected. It's a massive no-take zone. If you worry about all these other things where there's probably seagrasses and soft corals and corals and dugongs and a massive diversity of fish, then you should be worried because virtually none of them are conserved. How did that happen? This is the sad story. I was like, all good movies end sadly, don't they? So we've got to end on a sad story. What happened? Probably what's going to happen here. Who stopped us? Is the fishing industry very powerful and they stopped us? Fishing industry are powerful, but they're not that powerful. That's a map of oil and gas leases. That's 3 or 4 years old. Federal government even put this on their website. So it's not as a, now the oil and gas leases in fact cover the entire. This is the coastal shelf. And as far as the oil and gas people are concerned, there is possibly some oil and gas some everywhere. And I think a little bit like your country, our country refuses to forgo the opportunity to extract a cubic centimetre of fossil fuels from the ground. That's it. 120 years of wars tell you that's what governments do. So basically there's virtually no marine reserves anywhere where there could be fossil fuels. And I went into this battle, and my colleagues from the conservation world, the Pew Trust and other organisations, thinking that we were having a fight against the fishing industry. And we didn't realise there's a government department to do with mining and infrastructure, and they're so much more powerful than every other government department, it doesn't really matter. And they don't negotiate. They just draw lines on maps. So despite having all the science and all the knowledge, that's what we got. I'm going to leave you with one little thought before we have some questions. And I'm going to talk more about this on Friday night, I think. Friday afternoon I'm giving a talk somewhere, Peter tells me. Forestry, to the general public. So they might, did they get a biscuit if they turn up? A cookie? Maybe. I'm going to talk more about monitoring, but for those of you who are interested in data and gathering data, I'm going to tell you a story that might make you wonder about the data you collected. A lot of us collect data in conservation, in economics and social science with the view that our data can inform decision making. And we love it. And I'm going to just tell you this one story and you can think about it till Friday. I went to a conference in Scotland, and it was a conference of some of the best statistical, ecological, environmental modellers in the world. They do this stuff really, really well. Brilliant statisticians, brilliant environmental modellers. It was at, I can't remember the town it was in. It was their conference, and they had a person, I was giving a plenary on the last day, and they had a couple of talks, and a couple of the talks were about puffins. Cute, and they're really worried about the puffins disappearing because of climate change. And they have a whole heap of islands off the east coast of Scotland, and they had a bit of data. They had a couple of islands that were visited every year, then they had a few islands that had been visited twice, and they'd just been given £1 million, $2 million, to design a perfect monitoring system to reject the null hypothesis, to give them the maximum statistical power to reject the null hypothesis that puffins are not in decline because of climate change. So that was their purpose. So the null hypothesis is they wanted to prove that puffins really were in decline, and they were given £1 million, and they were given 5 to 10 years to operationalize that. And they did a brilliant power analysis, they did brilliant design, and they worked out exactly, each island has different costs to get to, how do they monitor which islands in which ways to actually answer this question perfectly. This is classic, like your perfect science, experimental design, honours undergraduate project, sort of on steroids at a high level. And they, when I gave my plenary, I said, why? This is a conservation project, you're spending £1 million, what are you going to do? What are you going to do when you discover that puffins are in decline and it's probably climate change? What's your action? What would you do? So, write to China. China, please stop burning coal. Write to Australia. Please, Australia, stop selling your coal to China. We have to take responsibility as well. Buy the puffins a fridge each, so they can keep, well, it's actually the sand eels that are disappearing, so you need to buy all the sand eels a fridge in the water. What's the action? And I said, this is ridiculous. You're doing science for science's sake. The government's fobbing you off, pretending they're doing something. There is no action. If there's nothing you can do about it, why do you need to know? So they weren't very happy, and they were a bit crumpy. So that night at the conference dinner, while I was sitting alone, and they were drinking their whiskey, a couple of them came up to me, and later in the evening, they'd had enough whiskies to get Scottish bravery and chat to me, and I said, Hugh, we're a bit upset with your talk. We've been thinking about it. We now know what the action is. We now know that if we prove this, that puffins will disappear from Scotland. Therefore, the main place in the world where there will be puffins will be Greenland. So we need to tell them. So, okay, there is an action. And I said, well, actually, you know, the action costs sort of nothing. Write a letter to Greenland. Dear Greenland, please look after your puffins. We think you might be the only place in the world where they are alive. So if there's no action, you don't need to know anything. There's no choices. If there's only one action and it doesn't cost anything, just do it. You don't need to prove this. And I'll give credit to Barbara Taylor and Tim Gerardet, who have an incredible paper in 1995 that nobody seems to care about, nobody seems to read in conservation biology, called The Vaquita and the Northern Spotted Owl. Who has read that paper? Good. Glad. That means what I said was true. Nobody's read it. No. That paper they show, Vaquita is this funny little dolphin that lives in California, in Mexico, and it's caught in bycatch. They showed that by the time they could prove statistically that this thing should even be listed, there was something like a 60% chance it was already extinct. Okay, so science isn't everything. Gathering evidence is not everything. Sometimes you've got to realise the chance of the evidence gathering informing a decision or allowing you just go and do it. Or you shouldn't bother gathering the evidence. Or you should just say, I'm doing pure science and I'm not doing applied science. So I'll talk more about that later. So some of my views on monitoring. This is the problem. Monitoring is not a statistical, it's partly a statistical problem. Monitoring is really an optimisation problem. Monitoring is a problem in applied science of decision science. If you're doing applied science, it's how much money and time and effort should I spend gathering the information? And if I could have spent that money doing stuff, maybe I shouldn't gather the information. Or is monitoring that? I won't say that, therefore it's not on tape, so I don't get into trouble. So we've got a whole series of papers. So a lot of the stuff we've done, this cost effectiveness work, this spatial planning that work, is influencing, as we speak, many governments and big NGOs around the world. My ranting about thinking before you do monitoring for the purposes of conservation has impacted nobody whatsoever. We've written lots of papers, and we're really trying to get it out there and try and get to people think about what is the value of information and what information is important, what information is just interesting. And I'm going to end thanking my lab again and also pointing out that everything we do goes into a paper or goes into my talks, and neither of those things are particularly intelligible. However, we employ a person called David Salt who turns all our papers into little articles in a thing called Decision Point, which you can get online. And he actually makes the papers almost sound interesting. So if you want to know what we're doing, you just have to Google that, sign up. You will be bothered by one email per month, and you'll never get another email. We won't sell your emails to real estate agents. So that's a way of following what we do, and that's our way of trying to communicate to managers and policy people, and then there's about 4,000 managers and policy people around the world who subscribe to that magazine, and maybe some of them read it. Thank you very much. Happy to take questions, apparently from graduate students. I don't know how I identify them. This looks like one. Yep. Good. Yeah. Yeah. That's right. Definitely, and it's actually hard to work out what. Obviously, a lot of existing data. We couldn't do spatial planning without habitat maps. We couldn't. The IUCN rankings and those risk assessments are driven by people who have gathered information about population numbers and declines and distributions. So all those things have started to inform decision making. I think the key is what new data should we be gathering? So I think risk assessments, IUCN rankings, they're actually quite useful to a certain extent for decision making. If you want to see a really good example, the best people in the world that do this are at USGS in Patuxent, and there's a guy called Mike Runge and Jim Nichols and a whole group of people there, Sarah Converse. They've got a brilliant paper on hooping cranes, and they basically said, this is one of the most overstudied species in the planet, and it's highly endangered. What do we need to know to choose the critical invention? And many of the pieces of science that would be interesting, they don't need to know, and there's a couple that they do need to know. And that analysis, I think, is the gold standard of value of information analysis. You could argue, and when I give the full talk, all knowledge will one day be useful, and that's also true. So I would say that every piece of knowledge is gathered eventually, even pure mathematics, ends up being useful. It's just that when you're in conservation science and half the species on the planet are going to disappear in the next 100 years, you probably need to think about what's most important now. So it's probably more a matter of urgency than that this knowledge eventually won't be useful. And then some data, like a lot of citizen science data, comes for free, almost comes for free. So it's, again, a benefit-cost analysis. If something comes for free, then the value's the benefit-cost analysis, cost-effectiveness analysis is infinite because it's free. Not that anything is completely free. Yeah. So it's all a matter of weighing the cost of that data collection. Yeah. Don't lose your temper is a good strategy. Being ridiculously patient. Realising that you can deliver 1998, basically it's a bit like developing a new drug. If you're in a lab and you develop a new drug in the lab next week, when do you think somebody's going to put it in their mouth? It's going to be 20 years later. That's just the unfortunate fact that from discovery to implementation is sadly 20 years. And I would say that's true for everything we've done. And I didn't realise that, and so I get angry. And yelling at public servants and politicians apparently doesn't get you anywhere. So you've got to be patient, then you've got to wait for the right person, and you've got to wait for these champions. And individual champions appear, and you've got to, well, with politicians, you actually just have to basically be incredibly obsequious and pander to their egos repeatedly. It's quite sickening, but that's it, in general. And even senior public servants, because senior public servants think they are incredibly important. And they probably are. They wield a lot of power, but they see hierarchies. I've never been into an organisation which, state and federal level in Australia, you know, if you're talking to an ASO, I don't know if you have ASOs and here, Australian something, there are scale ASO 1 to 12, and if you speak to the wrong level and you speak to that level before you spoke to another level, then there's terrible trouble. So you know, we all work in this organisation called a university where the hierarchy's been not flattened, but it's fairly flat. In fact, sometimes I think it's upside down because I think I've got 150 bosses. But you go, these are very hierarchical people, and I you've got to get into their culture. If I had my time again, I wish I'd spent 2 or 3 years working for the public service, because that's the only way I think I'd fully understand what's going on. Yeah. General public, absolutely essential. I mean, in fact, often I'm talking to a politician and they say, Hugh, I agree with you, that's very sensible. When you can get half the Australian people to write to me and tell me to do this as well, then we'll do it. That's it. We are not governed by people who have visions for countries, we are governed by populists. I think this country, United States, Australia, most of Europe, they are elected because more than 50% of the people voted for them, and they will do things that will guarantee that they're more than 50% of people vote for them next time. Yep, so in Australia I work very, very close with the NGOs and they use me to help with their popular campaigns by providing a science voice, so trying to provide some sort of veneer of credibility to whatever they do. But also I know that they're doing the campaigning, they're getting the letter writing going, they're doing the protesting, they're meeting backbenchers in critical electorates, and they're harassing them on a daily basis until the politicians think that everybody wants these things. Mind you, with Australia, the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park, 91% of Australians want the entire thing, a complete no-take area. And we only got 33%, so. The other thing is most governments, our Westminster system leads us towards relatively conservative moves, and everything is slow. So, it's just, yep.
So if you chatted a bit about, I don't know what you think about privatization, you've also mentioned how politics kind of sidelines.
Yeah. 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 Well, I suppose, yeah, conservation opportunity, and I mean, it's, it's about what people feel and the government and political science and all those other things. And I must admit, I don't understand conservation opportunity. All I know is it happens. And all I know is I have to be there when it happens. That's about it. I don't know whether there's a theory of it. We have started to do a little bit of work, and I've got a brilliant postdoc, Marina Mills, who's working with Mike Masher on conservation initiatives going viral. How can you create something that spreads? And what is the rate of spread of those new ideas? And that's a topic, this notion of the disease-like spread of innovation is, I think, an interesting possibility and is relevant in conservation. And then how do you start these diseases these good diseases spreading through communities? And how do you make them go so that most of the people get sick with this disease of being a conservationist or doing the right thing, like recycling or having easements over their property? I think that's an interesting area, but if you want to read something about that, don't read anything I've written. Read something that Mike Mash has written, probably. Yeah. Yeah, MISCIA. He works for Conservation International now. And, yeah. Right, yes. Thanks. Good. Thanks a lot. Thanks. Thanks, Peter. Yes. Yes. Okay, good. Okay, from my